Important thing going on here is that the president, of course, isn't alone in his crusade to try to dismantle or roadblock the Russia investigation and all of its component parts by going after key personnel and officials who have connections to different parts of the investigation. This is from an almost lyrical portrait more than 20 years ago. It was written in 1996. It was published in the New York Times, about the head of a drug gang in the Bronx and the criminal organization that he ran in the Bronx. Quote, when the history is written of the drug gangs of New York in the 1980s and the mid-1990s, the kind that wrecked a city's nerves, helped create record high murder rates, and made gunfire a common sound in many neighborhoods, the author of that history might want to spend a chapter on Jose Reyes, or as he was known, El Feo. Calm, charismatic, and predatory, Jose Reyes rose to become both dealer and supplier, building an empire. Operating in a neighborhood doused in drug money, Mr. Reyes was a general in an army. He also devoured books on the mafia. He read Machiavelli. He argued Gibran's philosophy. And he killed, managing a hit team that left a trail of rivals dead in Manhattan and the Bronx. He was so well insulated that it took law enforcement authorities several years to even hear of his existence. When they did, they were often amazed at his reach. 2 months ago, Mr. Reyes was convicted of running a drug organization and of killing seven men. This guy's name was Jose Reyes. They called him El Feo, which means the ugly one. And it was one of the legendary gang prosecutions of that whole era. His whole organization, but also he himself, indicted in 1994. They tried El Feo, they tried Jose Reyes in federal court in New York City. The judge deliberated for 8 days. When they came back, they ruled that he was guilty of seven murders, which meant, of course, life in prison. Prosecution was led in part by an assistant U.S. attorney in the Southern District of New York who was thought of as a bit of a brainiac before law school. He had graduated from Harvard with a degree in physics. After he helped bring that successful landmark El Feo prosecution in New York, that assistant U.S. attorney got a big promotion. He was named chief of the violent gangs unit for the whole Southern District of New York. It would not be long, though, before Maine Justice Department, D.C., hired him away from the U.S. attorney's office in New York. And at Maine Justice in D.C., he rose quickly to lead the organized crime and racketeering section for the whole Department of Justice. His specialty was international organized crime. To run that section, he became known as an intricate manager. He liaised the Justice Department not just with the FBI, but with other law enforcement and intelligence agencies all around the world. He built and maintained those contacts for the benefit of the Justice Department. And that makes sense. He was leading a team that was prosecuting international organized crime. So you need those intel and international law enforcement connections. In 2003, he oversaw the team that indicted the boss of all bosses in the Russian mafia. And that made big news at the time. I have to admit, though, the big news it made at the time when the Justice Department indicted the godfather of the Russian mafia was it was somewhat limited by the fact that nobody could pronounce the name of the guy they'd just indicted.
Today we have some of the FBI's most wanted for you. This is Simon Mogilevich. He's wanted for racketeering, securities fraud, wire and mail fraud, and money laundering. We're told he has pockmarks on his face, smokes heavily, and uses a Russian passport. He's considered armed and dangerous.
I am no better at pronouncing Russian names than the next guy. I think it's Semyon Mogilevich. I've been practicing. That's probably still wrong. Semyon Mogilevich is considered to be the godfather of the Russian mob. He's one of the most wanted men in the world. He has been for years. He's a fugitive from justice. He's under indictment in the United States. He's on the most wanted list for the FBI, but they haven't been able to get him. Very few pictures of him even exist. Mogilevich's name has turned up, though, in a couple of different ways in the Russia investigation involving President Trump, a Russian-born ex-con who worked for a while at the Trump Organization, who worked with Michael Cohen on the plan to try and build a Trump Tower in Moscow during the presidential campaign, that effort that then-candidate Donald Trump inexplicably lied about and publicly denied during the campaign. He has been described publicly as having links to Semyon Mogilevich and his organized crime network, although he denies any such link. Semyon Mogilevich also turns up in Paul Manafort's business history, because at one point, Paul Manafort pursued what would have been a gigantic real estate deal in New York City with some Russian-linked Ukrainian business partners. That real estate deal never came to pass, but it was the subject of litigation in the U.S. and great controversy in Ukraine, because that would-be real estate deal was suspected of essentially being a way for Paul Manafort to help launder some of Semyon Mogilevich's money that he had earned as head of the Russian mob. So Semyon Mogilevich, this top figure in the Russian mafia, starring role on the FBI's 10 most wanted international fugitives list, a guy who periodically leads to headlines like this one whenever the FBI starts talking about him again. FBI, mobster more powerful than Gotti. The Justice Department official who actually led the effort to indict Semyon Mogilevich, led the effort to bring him to justice in U.S. courts. That's the same Harvard brainiac who had come up from gang duty in the Southern District of New York after prosecuting the drug gangs in El Feo. Right? Soon after he got to the Justice Department, he indicted the head of the Russian mafia. He also played another key role in the case of another bold-faced name who has ended up having a starring role in the Russia scandal and the legal trouble surrounding this president and his campaign. I mentioned those 1,500 pieces of evidence that the special counsel's office says they're going to use every single one of in their trial for Paul Manafort in Washington, D.C. Well, at least a couple of those pieces of evidence appear to explicitly reference a Russian oligarch linked to Vladimir Putin whose name is Oleg Deripaska. He is apparently going to play a role in the Manafort trial coming up in D.C. You will also remember that Oleg Deripaska's name surfaced in reporting earlier this year when the Atlantic magazine and the Washington Post turned up emails that indicated that while Manafort was running Trump's presidential campaign, he was simultaneously offering private briefings on the election and the campaign to this Russian oligarch, to Oleg Deripaska. Last year, last spring, the Associated Press reported that Manafort had entered into a $10 million a year contract with Oleg Deripaska to promote the interests of Vladimir Putin's government around the globe. Well, in 2006, that same Justice Department official, the one who had started as the gang prosecutor, taking apart those drug gangs in the Bronx, the guy who had worked his way up to becoming an expert on transnational organized crime, the guy who led the team that brought the prosecution of the head of the Russian mafia, that same official, quote, was part of a group of government officials who revoked the visa of Oleg Deripaska, a Russian billionaire and aluminum magnate. Officials were concerned that Mr. Deripaska might try to come to the United States to launder illicit profits through real estate. The Russia scandal around this president, and particularly the part of it that has led to these two federal criminal trials against the president's campaign chairman, it has an organized crime element to it. It has a Russian organized crime element to it. And now, as the president mulls pardoning Paul Manafort, and he mulls replacing his White House counsel if the White House counsel won't let him pardon Paul Manafort, as the president openly mulls firing the Attorney General of the United States in the midst of the Manafort prosecution as a way to try to make the Russia investigation all go away, today, Republicans in Congress spent the entire day going after that Justice Department official I've been talking about, that specific official who started with the El Feo case and the drug gangs in the Bronx, who rose to become the head of organized crime and racketeering at the Justice Department, who became the Justice Department's expert on Russian organized crime, the guy who indicted the head of the Russian mafia, the guy who became the Justice Department's lead counsel for transnational organized crime and international affairs, the guy who had been part of the team that banned Paul Manafort's patron and business partner, Oleg Deripaska, from doing business or visiting the United States on the basis of his alleged ties to organized crime in Russia. That Justice Department official, that guy, is named Bruce Orr. And he is the object of conspiracy theories and condemnation on right-wing media on a 24-hour loop. And today, pro-Trump Republican members of Congress summoned Bruce Orr to testify behind closed doors before two separate Republican-led committees. And then, despite the closed-door nature of his testimony, those Republicans immediately went out to the cameras to talk to reporters about how Bruce Orr was a liar and to basically accuse him of being the rot at the heart of the Mueller investigation and the Russia scandal more broadly. The New York Times this weekend profiled Bruce Orr's long history in leading American law enforcement efforts against Russian organized crime. There is a Russian organized crime element to the Trump-Russia scandal. Today, House Republicans literally came back from their summer vacation early to spend the day trying to destroy Bruce Orr. From Politico.com today, quote, House Republicans have fixated on a handful of career Justice Department and FBI officials over the past year as they've sought to cast doubt on the legitimacy of the investigators who launched the Russia probe. First, the spotlight was on Jim Comey and Andrew McCabe, then Peter Strzok and Lisa Page. Now Republicans, intent on proving that political bias is behind the sprawling investigation of President Trump's ties to Russia, now Republicans are elevating a new bureaucratic target, Justice Department official Bruce Orr. You know, when they went after Peter Strzok, they were going after the top counterintelligence official at the FBI with experience in breaking up Russian intelligence operations on U.S. soil. In going after Bruce Orr today, they're trying to take out one of American law enforcement's top experts on Russian organized crime. And I don't know exactly what these targeted attacks by the White House and congressional Republicans will ultimately do to the capabilities of the Justice Department and the FBI when it comes to fighting things like Russian intelligence operations in the United States and Russian organized crime and Russian money laundering through American real estate, right? But you can imagine how satisfying a day like today must have been for Semyon Mogilevich to see Bruce Orr get his turn in the barrel like this, right? You can imagine how delightful that was for the Russian mafia. You can imagine what a nice turn of events today must have been when viewed from the perspective of the Kremlin.